National Federation of the Blind. Live the life you want through science, technology, engineering, and math.
Blind STEM professionals share their experience.
Hi, I'm Cindy Bennett, and I'm a blind PhD student at the University of Washington in the Department of Human-Centered Design and Engineering.
Hi, I'm Gary Wunder, and I'm a blind computer scientist.
Hi, my name is Mark Halcero, and I'm a blind PhD student in biomedical engineering.
Hi, I'm Jamie, and I'm studying to be a physicist, and I'm blind.
Hi, I'm Dr. Carrie Cipollo, and I'm a blind chemist.
I became inspired to become a STEM professional after I finished my undergraduate degree in psychology. I began working in a computer science department at the University of Washington on some accessibility research projects, and I realized that I could combine my social science background with a passion for technology to be able to join a lucrative and interesting workforce.
I've always been fascinated with electronics. The magic of being able to communicate with a wire or even without a wire when you come down to radio. And the idea that you could actually make a machine that could add, subtract, multiply, divide, could do it faster than human beings, and that I could learn to program it was a really cool idea to me.
I think I always have had a natural curiosity for understanding how things work, whether it's something in nature or something more physical like chemistry or machines, but I've always had a curiosity for that, so I've pursued it throughout my education. And then coming into the STEM fields, I find that it's an excellent way to give back to society, so I really enjoy the aspect of being able to make positive change through science, and so that's what's kept me into STEM.
I've always been really curious about the world. In a way, I think I've always been a scientist. When I was little, I would spend a lot of time asking questions about why and how things work, and sometimes even designing my own experiments to understand things better. So I always knew I wanted to be a scientist. I just didn't really know how a blind person could do it. So when people would ask what I wanted to be when I grew up, I would cycle through things that I thought were a little bit more likely for me to achieve, like teacher or writer or social worker or something. But I was never happy with these ideas. I really just wanted to do science.
When I was an undergraduate student at Purdue University, I didn't know what I wanted to be when I grew up, and I was inspired by the chemistry courses I was enrolled in as a freshman to work really hard to understand this. At the time, was very complicated material. And as I worked hard at things, I started experiencing more and more success with the material, and it started a snowball effect, started rolling a little bit more, and I got into it more quickly and became bigger and faster, and before I knew it, I was a chemistry type guru. And understanding the world the way it is and why things are the way they are really, really has motivated me since I was a child, and a chemistry profession was a good way to pursue that interest.
I first realized that I could do STEM as a blind person after my undergraduate degree in psychology. I began working in a computer science department at the University of Washington, and the students in the lab believed in me. There were never any discussions about what I could or could not do as a blind person, and whenever we encountered inaccessible technologies, the research team was very supportive at finding ways of communicating that worked for everyone and at encouraging me to learn how to program and to become a better researcher. At this time, I also started connecting with other blind STEM professionals, and learning from them absolutely inspired me to pursue STEM.
Well, I always wanted to go into the sciences, but the further I got along in school, the more I was told that STEM really wasn't a possibility for me, that I should concentrate on something in the social sciences, something that would rely less on direct observation, that would rely less on using my hands, that would be more read about it, write about it. And one day I was telling a professor that I really liked philosophy and political science, but I wished I could find a way to go into the field of electronics. And he said, I don't know why you're choosing your second choice and your third choice before you've given yourself a chance for your first choice. I don't know whether you can make it or not, but it seems to me that anybody who respects themselves would at least try their first choice And thank God you have second and third ones to fall back on. So I don't know if this will work, but let's try it.
So I lost my vision when I was 16, and I attended training at the Louisiana Center for the Blind. And at that time, when I had lost my vision, I had kind of lost hope of pursuing my career in STEM. But I think with my experiences at LCB and having that initial empowerment, I saw that I could continue to do what I had wanted to do, and it empowered and enabled me to continue this career option going on to college and then now into my graduate studies.
I struggled a lot with mathematics in college. I would even have some professors at various institutions turn me away and say, "You can't do math if you're blind." And I started to believe them until I went to a new school in Colorado and decided to start off with just a math class. It was college algebra, and I didn't want my teacher to have any assumptions about me. So when I walked into class on the first day and he was asking all of the students, "How do you feel about math? How do you do at math?" I lied through my teeth. And I told him that I'm excellent at math. I've always been head of my class, and it's my favorite subject ever. And then I spent the rest of the semester trying to not get caught in my lie. By the end of the semester, I had an A in the class, and I was kind of blown away by this, and I was finding that I really enjoyed the subject. I was talking to a friend of mine one night, and I was telling him about it, and I was telling him about how all I really want to do is understand how the universe works. And he looked at me and he said, "Well, why don't you major in physics?" And I looked at him like he was crazy, but he said he wasn't joking. This is a sighted person who's well-educated, who's brilliant in math and science, telling me that I could be a physicist. And I thought, well, I made it through college algebra, and I really like math, and I really like science. What do I have to lose? I'm going to give it a try.
I first took an interest in STEM-type content back when I was in fourth grade. And there I was discovering that I was really good at math, and arithmetic calculations and doing things in my head was a lot of fun to me. And as I progressed through middle school, I started learning more about the life sciences and physical sciences, and I wanted to understand more about how math and science related to one another. And when I got to high school, that was my first initial opportunity to really pursue that in multiple classes. And then, of course, leapfrogging from high school into college. And you know, there are the gateway courses of calculus and chemistry and physics that are designed to be very difficult for students because they want to sort of weed out the pretenders, if you will. I wasn't sure if I could do it initially until I met a blind chemistry professor, Dr. David Wohlers at Truman State University in Kirksville, Missouri. He came to Purdue, where I was an undergraduate student, and gave a research talk, and they had arranged it so that I could have dinner with him and spend extra time with him before and after the presentation and on his visit. And he inspired me because I realized having a tangible person that I could hear and talk to and learn from, that if I worked hard at this, I could figure out how to do it, and I could do it myself.
My greatest challenge has been learning to program in a classroom environment. So part of the reason for this challenge is that I'm a graduate student working with technical people, and so I'm trying to catch up. But to do that, I've signed up for a couple of programming classes, and the greatest challenge is when the technology tools that the rest of the class is using are not accessible, when I have to use alternative development environments from the other students, the teacher isn't ready to support me, and so I have to do extra work to learn how to use accessible tools. And the other big challenge is when professors don't say out loud what they're writing on the board or typing on their computer. A lot of computer science professors code during class, and it's a really interactive way to help students to understand the content as well as making errors and working through debugging code. but often professors don't announce, especially non-textual characters, and it's really difficult, even if I have the notes in front of me, trying to map what they're saying to what part of the notes they're referring to. So that's probably the biggest challenge, is when there's not enough verbal information in the classroom.
Well, my greatest challenge in school was getting materials in a form that I could read and getting professors to articulate what it was they were talking about. You know, if we were dealing with something as simple as Ohm's law and you were trying to figure out the current flowing through a circuit, you could say voltage over resistance equals current. But that isn't the way they said it. They said if you take this and you divide it by this, you come up with this. And you have to do a lot of asking about, okay, what is the this in all of that? That was the problem in school. The interesting problem was in work, the assumption was that if I got through school, I could probably do the work. And my first boss said that he almost didn't hire me because he thought that it would require too much effort to get me to the workplace, home again, to find me lunch and to take me to the bathroom. And he said, you know, we just didn't have the kind of staff to do that sort of thing. And I said, so you weren't worried about whether I could do the work or not? And he said, no, I figured if they sent you here, you could already program. I just figured you'd take a lot of maintenance. And when you came here on your own and you didn't ask me for anything, I was convinced that if you worked out with the rest of the staff, you were a hire.
The most difficult aspect of what I do is probably lab bench science. So working at the bench, working with different tools, performing cell culture, which requires very precise hand-eye coordination and working with a variety of tools in a very rapid manner, using microscopy and being able to analyze the images for different aspects of what you might be looking for. And so work as an undergrad doing reading books and doing tests was not as difficult as long as you can get the accommodations that you need, but the most difficult part of science so far has been actually doing it in the laboratory.
For me, one of the biggest challenges that I encountered both in undergraduate schooling and in graduate school was misconceptions by faculty in my department, in the chemistry department, as to the capabilities of a blind person, how they would actually do innovative research. And the first happened when I was a senior at Purdue, and I approached a professor that inspired me to want to go on to graduate school and to pursue chemistry as a profession. And I asked him, after having taken three of his courses and doing quite well in them, if he would support me writing me a recommendation letter to graduate school, and he said he would not, because he didn't know how I would perform the job as competitively as a sighted student would be able to. And so for me, that was a real downer. But through a semester-long effort and educating of him and other faculty as to the capabilities and the historical perspective of blind people in STEM-type professions in the past, I persuaded him to give me that recommendation letter in the end for graduate school. So I was very inspired by that. And then in graduate school, you have to choose a research advisor. And I interviewed faculty member number 1, 2, 3, and 4. I was expected to interview with a minimum of 4. And faculty member number 3, I met with him and we discussed his work and how exciting it was, and how I explained to him how I, as a blind person, was going to do my work, working with Braille and tactile graphics, and undergraduate students helping me to do the synthetic work at the benchtop, and I would design all my experiments based on literature and through consultation with him as the faculty member, and it all sounded fine. And when I got down to the end of it, I said, well, you know, would you be open to the idea of me joining your research group? He said no. And I asked him for clarification as to why, and he said, I view you as a financial liability, and why should I spend my limited grant research dollars on you when I could spend them on someone else that would be more productive? And of course, I didn't know what really to say to that, and so it sort of set me back on my heels, if you were, and I left that meeting and went to meeting number 4, and met with the faculty member that ended up turning out to be my research advisor. And I asked him, after I explained how I was going to do all my work and working with undergraduate students, if he had any concerns. And he said, no. He said, Carrie, you've been problem-solving to overcome your physical challenges for, in essence, your entire life. That is the essence of what a scientist does, and I view that as an asset to your research.
No one ever comes up to me and says, you can't do this because you're blind. People have become a little bit more polite than that. But in the nuances of the ways that people interact with me, I can gauge that there might be some assumptions about what I can do. So one thing I make an effort to do are really simple, even non-work-related tasks, like getting people coffee. When I was a TA in the fall, my professor would often set up the classroom and do menial tasks that were typical of the TA, such as turning on the projector, passing out supplies. And so when I noticed that was happening, I made an effort to show up to class early and to start performing those tasks before the professor could get there. And then when he arrived, he could see, oh, Cindy's already done this. This isn't a big deal. And the other ways I circumvent that is when I suspect that there might be some assumptions. A lot of it is around navigating technologies. I try to have open communication with my collaborators and explain when things really are not accessible, and always offering a way that I can do it a different way or to collaboratively brainstorm if I don't have a solution ready at hand.
I never had anyone assume that I couldn't do my work because I was blind. They worried about whether or not I could get there and whether I could handle the mobility required to be a colleague. But I don't think I ever had anyone say, I'm not going to give you this assignment because. Now, there were times when the technology that was available and its relative inaccessibility made certain assignments pretty hard. But I tried to make that a situation that I dealt with rather than one that other people had to deal with.
I would assume that they assume that you can not do most of it or any of it. But I think that the parts that are particularly difficult or most obvious to people would be things like microscopy that are entirely visual, or things that require very precise working, such as with working with cell culture, for example, that requires very precise hand-eye coordination.
This has become less and less of an issue the longer I've been in the field. But in the beginning, a lot of people assumed that I wouldn't be able to set up or use delicate or dangerous equipment to do experiments. Some examples of this would be soldering irons, electrical components, lasers, all kinds of things, even things as simple as a swinging pendulum. But in reality, I can do all of this. I just need to do it a little bit differently. And a lot of my colleagues just needed to see that a few times before they believed it.
So sometimes my colleagues assume that I can't work in an effective timetable as non-visually impaired counterparts because it takes blind people longer to do things. And in some cases, that can be true. And we as blind professionals just need to be willing to make the time commitment to do that work. For example, grading handwritten work. It takes a long time to go over one student's work and over again until you are satisfied with the answers that you've received, and providing the feedback that you want to give. Dictating the feedback to a sighted person to then hand-scribe it on the page in red ink and making sure that it's written the way you want it, because you don't want to create any offense and things of that sort. But then that's time that I'm willing to give as a commitment to my profession and to my students learning and being successful.
And that's how blind people do STEM. For more information, visit blindscience.org.